Hi, and welcome back to first year undergraduate microeconomics. Today, we're going to talk about the relationship between the elasticity of demand and the slope of a demand curve. In particular, we're going to be asking the question, why do we actually use the elasticity of demand rather than simply looking at the slope of a demand curve when we want to think about how, for example, quantity changes when the price of a good changes? First, just a quick reminder. An elasticity is the percentage change in quantity divided by the percentage change in something else. And we have been looking at the own price elasticity of demand, which is the percentage change in the quantity demanded of a good divided by the percentage change in the price of the same good. Our formula for the own price elasticity of demand is given here, just as a reminder. On the top part of our fraction, we have the percentage change in the quantity of good I that is demanded. And on the bottom part of the fraction, we have the percentage change in the price of good I. It's the own price elasticity of demand because we're looking at the change in quantity of good I demanded for a change in the price of good I. And whenever the demand curve slopes down, if price goes up, quantity demanded falls. If price goes down, quantity demanded rises. So our own price elasticity of demand will be negative because quantity and price move in the opposite direction. However, economists often leave the negative sign off and just simply refer to own price elasticities of demand as positive numbers. And just a final reminder from last time, on this slide we have the exact formula for the own price elasticity of demand for any point on our demand curve. Remember, the percentage change in quantity divided by the percentage change in price is going to be an approximation whenever we work with real world data. However, on this slide, we have the exact formula. It's got two bits, this bit over here on the left, which is simply 1 over the slope of the demand curve at the relevant point. Just as a reminder, slope is rise over run, change in price over change in quantity. Here we have change in quantity over change in price. So this is 1 over the slope of the demand curve. And the second part is simply price divided by quantity at the point we're interested in. So we can use this formula to get an exact measure of the own price elasticity of demand of a demand curve at a particular price-quantity combination. Now, in order to use this formula, we need to know the slope of the demand curve. But if we know the slope of a demand curve and we're interested in how quantity changes when there's a change in price, why do we need the second bit over here? Or in other words, why don't we just use the slope of a demand curve whenever we are interested in, for example, how a change in price due to government policy changes the quantity traded in a market? There's two main reasons why we use elasticity rather than simply the slope of a demand curve. The first one, as we've seen in our earlier presentation, is that elasticity and expenditure are directly related. That is useful, but it's actually not the most important reason why we want to use the elasticity of demand rather than the slope of a demand curve. To see the most important reason, we need to understand that the elasticity of demand is unitless. What do we mean by that? Well, the elasticity of demand is percentage change in quantity divided by percentage change in price. Percentage divided by percentage gives a measure that doesn't depend on units. It doesn't depend on how we're measuring quantity, and it doesn't depend on how we're measuring price. Why is that important? Well, let's imagine you want to look at how the quantity of eggs demanded changes when the price of eggs change. If you're using the slope of the demand curve, that slope's going to depend on how you measure the eggs. If you measure the quantity of eggs in terms of dozens of eggs, that's going to give you a different slope to if you measure the slope in terms of individual eggs. In contrast, if you talk about percentage change for your quantity, it doesn't matter whether you're looking at the percentage change in terms of dozens of eggs or the percentage change in terms of individual eggs. You get the same answer. Okay, you say. So we've got to be a little bit careful if we use the slope. But actually, it's more problematic than that. Let's suppose you're doing a comparison across countries. You're looking, for example, at the international trade of eggs. Or you want to look at how the change in policy has a different effect on the egg market in different countries. Well, if you're in Australia, eggs will be priced in dollars and cents. But if you're in Japan, for example, eggs are priced in yen. And if you're in India, eggs are priced in rupee. So in that situation, if you start talking about the slope of the demand curve for eggs, even if you've got the same units of quantity, say dozens of eggs, your prices are necessarily in different units. In Australia, it's dollars and cents. In Japan, it's yen. In India, it's rupee. Now, of course, you could convert between, say, dollars and yen and rupee, but what exchange rate would you use? The price or the exchange rate of dollars in terms of yen and rupee changes every day. So if you wanted to use the slope of the demand curve to compare the Japanese egg market to the Indian egg market to the Australian egg market, you would be stuffed because you don't have the same units for your price. You immediately have a problem that you need an exchange rate to be able to compare between your countries, and there is no unambiguous exchange rate to use. How do we get around that? Well, elasticity is the answer, because if you're looking at the own price elasticity of the demand for eggs, and your price is in dollars, or your price is in yen, or your price is in rupee, it doesn't matter, because you're looking at the percentage change in the price. So using elasticity rather than slope allows us to make comparisons between countries and also over time in a way that using the slope of the demand curve just cannot do. That being said, understanding that elasticity and the slope of the demand curve are closely related is really helpful. For example, here we've got a demand curve. Let's imagine that we were trying to work out the elasticity of demand at this particular point, price of P0 and quantity of Q0. Well, here I've got a demand curve that is relatively flat, while this second demand curve is pretty steep. What can we immediately say about the elasticity of demand of these two different demand curves at P0 and Q0? Well, as P0 and Q0 are the same for both demand curves, we immediately know that the elasticity of demand at this particular point will go up as the slope of the demand curve goes down. So because our first demand curve is relatively flat compared to our second demand curve, we know that this demand curve is going to be more elastic or have a higher absolute value for the own price elasticity of demand at P0 and Q0, whereas our second demand curve, which is relatively steep, is going to be less elastic or have a lower level of elasticity in absolute value terms at the price P0 and Q0. So if we're comparing different demand curves at the same price quantity combinations, then the steeper the demand curve, the lower the elasticity at that point. We can take that a bit further by noting that if we have a perfectly horizontal demand curve, such as the one we've got here, then we have an infinitely elastic demand curve. What does that mean? Well, notice that for this particular demand curve, if price is above P0, quantity is zero. If price is below P0, quantity is out here at infinity. So for a tiny change in price, there's an infinite change in quantity. Percentage change in quantity, infinity, divided by a small percentage change in price, that means that this demand curve is infinitely, or what we say, perfectly elastic. In contrast, here we have a vertical demand curve. Notice that for this particular demand curve, if the price goes up or the price goes down, it doesn't matter. The quantity demanded stays constant at Q0. So the percentage change in quantity is zero for any percentage change in price. So this vertical demand curve has a zero elasticity, or we say it is perfectly inelastic. Finally, just a trick which first years often fall into. Remember that our exact formula for elasticity is given up here. 1 over the slope of the demand curve at a point times the price divided by the quantity at that point. Here we've got a straight line demand curve. Remember, if it's a straight line, the slope is the same no matter where you are on that demand curve. But that doesn't mean that the demand curve has the same elasticity at every point. In fact, the exact opposite holds true. Because the slope is the same at every point, whenever we move along the curve and change the ratio price to quantity, the elasticity changes. So, let's say we want to know the elasticity of demand at P1 and Q1. This point here on the demand curve, we'll notice P1's relatively high, Q1's relatively low, so PI on QI is a relatively big number, so at this point we're going to have a relatively high elasticity of demand. In contrast, at this second point, P0 and Q0, at that point on the demand curve, the ratio of price to quantity is lower, so we know that the elasticity of demand is going to be lower at that point. Both points have the same slope, but the ratio of price to quantity is higher at P1, Q1 than it is at P0, Q0. So as we move along a straight line demand curve, as we move up to the northwest, from P0, Q0 to P1, Q1, we're going to get an increase in the elasticity of demand along that linear demand curve. So in summary, we use the elasticity of demand rather than the slope of the demand curve when we're thinking about how quantity changes for a change in price, because elasticity is unitless. And that is really important, particularly when making comparisons between different countries that use different currencies. Secondly, understanding how slope and elasticity are related to each other makes it easier to work out elasticity. In particular, we've seen the examples of a perfectly elastic demand curve and a perfectly inelastic demand curve. That's it for now. Talk to you next time.